So the late 1990s were the good days for Korean internet because, first of all, we had a very great infrastructure for broadband. So the three sort of important countries in the Northeast Asia would be China, Japan, and Korea. And obviously, Korea is being the smallest country of them. But in terms of economic size, we're not very that small. I mean, you know, not by a very, you know, terribly, terribly big margin. And this is a GDP, and as you can see, the export, we were doing about one-third of China and about, or actually slightly more than half of Japan. So that was terribly, you know, not terribly bad. But when it comes to the land size, it's a whole different story. So if China was size of watermelon, and if Japan was strawberry, then Korea would be the size of a pea. And don't forget to cut that in half because, you know, countries divided. My teacher would say that 70% of whole country is actually mountains where people cannot live. So that leaves us only 30% of half a pea. But surprisingly, this is also home to some 48 million people. So obviously Korea is one of the most crowded and busiest and craziest society. And we thought this was a bad thing. You know, Korea being a small country, that's a bad thing. Until, that is, the broadband penetration, you know, came around. And when the broadband came around, you know, Korea being a small country actually to its advantage, where this is the figures from 2000, and already in 2000, 94% of all internet users in Korea were on broadband. And if you see the numbers from like other countries, this is really amazing and dramatic. And wireless too. And I mean, the wireless, you know, connection in Korea was so good that we couldn't actually get out of it. So people were getting the call. We couldn't get out of it. So when we were watching the American movies where the good guys are being chased by the bad guys, and then, you know, they pick up the phone to, you know, make a call to, you know, get some help, and there's like no signal, and we're like, why? And when I was working at a phone company, we actually had to create a shield room, something that looks like a refrigerator, just to, you know, keep the wireless connection off. So this was pretty amazing. And so that was the infrastructure, and now there's the people. You know, Koreans are really homogeneous people, and we share a lot of interest. So from, you know, ranging from, like, you know, World Cup games to social issues, Koreans share a lot of social issues. And as you can see here, one example is the X-File, you know, what we call X-File. This is sort of like the dirty laundry secrets of Korean entertainers that had been, you know, got leaked a couple of years ago. And everybody, there's a figure that says within the first 24 hours, half the nation actually saw this. So it really shows how much of a viral effect Korea had. And also on top of this, there was the government support. So there was pro-venture policies. And as a result, we had this Tehran Valley that's equivalent to Silicon Valley of the US. And so this led to a lot of, you know, new innovations, a lot of interesting innovations. There was, and many of those new innovations were actually world first. So for example, we were using internet telephone service a lot already in the late 1990s, thanks to a company called Dialpad. And everybody was having like one of these, and they were calling this Dialpad headset. And this actually preceded Skype by nearly 4 years. And also, the US is all about the virtual goods and virtual economy these days, but Koreans were used to this from the 90s as well. And Cyworld happens to precede Facebook by 5 years, nearly 5 years. And also, Naver Q&A service, this is a Q&A question and answer service, and it has 10 times more entries than the whole Wikipedia, and this was before Yahoo Answers by 3 years. And also Korea, of course, you know, gave birth to the first professional gaming league, online gaming league of the world, and these, you know, what we call the e-sport is now one of the most popular sports of any sport, you know, baseball, football, and then there's like e-sport. So this is pretty amazing. And this head start actually continues to this day, where Korea leads the world in you know, a lot of numbers in terms of internet usage. So 99.9% of teens are using the internet, and people spent about 1,600 minutes on the internet in February 2009, and this is average 56 minutes per day. And this is like includes everyone, including your own grandmother. So this is really amazing numbers if you think about it. And 11 million people using sites, and this is 13 times per month, and every time they were spending hours in each site. So Korea was amazing, but now, you know, I mean, the usage is there, but Korea is not really innovating anymore. Korea used to be innovators, but now it's not really innovating. Why? First, there is walled garden. Internet portals send most of the traffic to the content within those portals rather than sending the traffic out. So you can see there that like a lot of portals, you know, a lot of traffic is coming within the portals. And also the monoculture and the walled garden actually starts from the browser itself, where this is a recent figure from Internet Trend that says 98.5% of Koreans are using Internet Explorer. And this is pretty bad because I know you're laughing because you have seen like, you know, many times. And this essentially, in Korea, you cannot buy a Macintosh computer on Macintosh. You have to buy a PC first, because you're, you know, you cannot buy a from the online store. Your credit card doesn't come through. So, and also the mobile. This is from my service carrier, KTF, and they have like all these different plans. And they even have a plan called World Cup 2002 plan. And this day, I mean, they're giving 2002 minutes of free calls, but they're not giving me what I really want, which is affordable, unlimited data plan. I want that, but I cannot get it. And this is interesting because one time, you know, my sister, you know, paid a visit to our place, and you know, my nephew, a small kid, was playing with my phone, and then I heard my sister yelling, "Don't ever press that button. Who told you to press that button?" And that turned out to be that middle button that connects to the wireless internet. And interesting thing was, at that time I was writing a piece, a column about the Korean mobile internet industry, and that, you know, I realized that, well, if my own sister is doing this, this is really bad. And just imagine that, you know, mothers yelling at kids who are using the computers, "You can double click on any icons, but not that one, because that's expensive, and that's, you know, we don't have that, right?" So if you think about this, you can see how seriously wrong this is. And another issue is the government control. Obviously, you have to actually, in order to use major services of Korea, you have to go through a real identity verification system. Obviously, this makes it a lot more difficult for foreigners to try new Korean services. And this is also, you know, very, you know, stark contrast to these simple registration forms we're seeing a lot these days. And the idea of the government being able to know who you are when they want to, it's really jarring. And a lot of people actually went, you know, out of the Korean services, so-called cyber exiles. And this person, Cyber Pundit, who used to write a lot of, you know, critical pieces about the Korean government, the government, the prosecutors, you know, got to learn, you know, who his real identity and tracked him down. So this is really another, you know, factor. And the problem doesn't, I don't think, you know, problem lies only with the government or the service provider. So it actually lies with the people as well, where there's a lot of rampant, you know, illegal downloads. This is figures from last year. 47% of all internet users in Korea illegally downloaded 55 movies a year. So this is, again, the average. So this is pretty bad. So alarming signs. Korean internet used to be innovators, but not anymore. It's actually going the other direction. We're actually decreasing. So this is the annual figures. We saw some of the figures go down this year. Community service, social networks, mini homepage down 20%. And the mobile as well. So the mobile internet is pretty expensive, so people don't really use it. So we have lowest, if you see the right hand, we have the lowest percentage of mobile data services out of the total ARPU. And most, this means that most people use either voice phone calls or SMS communications or MMS, and that's pretty much it. So this is pretty bad. And you know, I'm just wondering, so I'm writing a blog about the Korean, you know, mobile and internet innovations, and these days my blog posting has been a little bit slow, and people are like, you know, you have to write more. And the reason why my blogging, you know, has slowed down is partly because I'm busy, but also because I don't see a lot of innovations around. So do we have any signs of hope? Do we see any signs of hope? You know, that's the next question. And I think we're seeing some signs of hope, but definitely there has to be more signs of hope, I guess. The major services are opening up. They embrace the open space and open internet a lot these days. iPhone is coming out, finally. So as you can see there, at least we're beating Qatar. Yeah, that's a good thing, yeah. even though we're behind Equatorial Guinea, you know, who cares? And people here would know that, you know, since there has been so much of rumors about the iPhone is coming out next month, you know, iPhone is actually nicknamed the next month phone. But finally, we're having iPhone finally in the next month. so people, I mean, you know, we've seen a lot of parodies about this, you know, iPhone stories. You know, people getting frustrated, but finally they find their ways like this. And, you know, people are better now because we've been through, like, all this time. And Twitter's interesting. I just saw that a lot of people are tweeting at this moment. So with the iPhone and Twitter, I think Koreans are finally, you know, at least giving a chance to the global services, I guess. And people like Professor Kim Gi-chang, he's been fighting against this monoculture. And the thing is that he lost a lawsuit again, but I don't think this is only a legal issue though. It's all about, so let's just imagine that we have cities like this where big city, i.e. with 40 million people on it, and then there's like smaller towns like Firefoxville and town. But we do know that, you know, people are living here. Then would we not be interested in building roads for them and building electricity for them and water system? We would probably do that, right? But we're not doing something like that in the online world, and that's really, I think, fundamentally wrong. And the illegal movie download, and you know, it's decreasing. The legal use of content, digital content, is going up, which are the good signs. But out of all these signs of hope, I think the most important thing is this. So the young entrepreneurs. So we have a group of young entrepreneurs that are really new generations, and they embrace the globalness from like day one. They're the ones that are really the brave souls. They want to fight against all the odds. They want to beat the odds, and they want to build great products, and they want to make it rich. I think these are the greatest signs of hope for Korean internet. And in fact, yesterday, two new services came out of these people only yesterday. So that's a very good thing. I think the society has to give a chance to these young entrepreneurs. For example, the government, we know that, you know, government is spending a lot of money on the civil engineering stuff. But I'm just hoping that, you know, they will spend more money to support these young entrepreneurs, and venture capitalists have to step forward and invest more in these young startups, because without these people, if we ever want to revive the Korean web, I think it has to start from these people. And without these people, there is really no future for the Korean web. Thank you.